So good morning, everyone. So we're going to be packed all together for 3 hours, so let's try to have some heat here. It's a bit freezing for me now. Okay, first of all, I would like to thank Mr. Chairman also for his kind wording. And it's a very great pleasure and honor to be participating to this Machine Learning Summer School. It's also my first time for me to come to Australia and to have an overview of both the research institutes, the activities, and how the city looks like. Although I just saw the campus for now. Maybe I will be relieved after the talk for some sightseeing. Well, it's also a good opportunity for me to test two summer time because, you know, in Paris now it's more like winter time and freezing, and then here we are all wearing shirts and a very pleasing environment. So I appreciate all this setting. So to come back of the topic of today, I will introduce you with the very basics of a new field that is called computational information geometry. And I will spend the first half of this lecture to introduce the basic concepts that has been described in that field, and then in the second part I will talk more about algorithms and application in machine learning of that paradigm. Okay, so what is computational information geometry? It's three words that are interlinked, and actually it's a framework that relies on several fields, so several well-known fields, like it is based on statistics and probability. It's also relying on information theory, as we will see. And for the learning curve of information geometry, one of the most difficult or technical field is differential geometry, how to use differential geometry, especially in a more general setting than Riemannian. Many people are used to Riemannian framework, and we will see that information geometry somehow goes above these Riemannian things. And of course, we are interested in computation because we are computer scientists and we are also programmers. So we like to program, and we like to have good programs so that we can make tricky coding by using some dualities between different concepts to make efficient programming. So what are the application fields of computational information geometry? It's expanding more and more and more. But just to give you a flavor, we have some application in computational statistics, of course, because geometrizing statistics has been the very first cornerstone of information geometry. And machine learning also, because machine learning is typically a lot of geometric insights into non-Euclidean spaces. So how to model with spaces and how to build algorithms in those spaces are very important. Information retrievals, because we want to build search engines and we want to organize and rank information into databases. Also computer vision, which may not be standard, like for example, even for edge detection, you have some work that relies on information geometry. Medical imaging, because we have a lot of modalities and we need to match, for example, ultrasound imagery with functional MRI, or we have diffusion tensor imaging that are using some kind of ellipsoid or covariance matrices and signal processing. So computational information geometry is rather a framework, okay? And it is a blend of all those things, and I will introduce you to a scenario so that we can see how it works. Is anyone having a laser pointer here? I forgot my tool, so if somebody has a laser pointer, it would be nice. No? Is there one? Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. Okay, thanks. So this is just a word with the main keywords you will encounter in the coming slides. So it gives you a flavor that we are very interested in geometry, distances, and we will have things like entropy and probability distributions and so on. Okay, but before I start, I would like to state some motivation and what are the goals we are looking at. So basically, I've split the goals into four main parts. The first goal is to try to understand what we mean by distances or distortions or dissimilarities, you know, or maybe in information geometry it's called divergences. And we don't want to understand them in an ad hoc manner, but rather into classes. We want to understand the very big classes of distances and how they compare with each other. And we will see that we have important classes that are called Bregman divergences or Csar F divergences. And people doing forecasting also use some kind of scoring rules. And the goal is that once we have understood those classes, we can build meta algorithms that will work for all those distances into the classes. Okay, we will have the same convergence property, for example, and we would like also to seek for properties of those classes so that we have exhaustivity. We can say, okay, that class of distance, I know that it has this property, and if it has this property, that distance belongs to that class. Okay, so this is kind of exhaustive. Quality. Second goal is to understand the relationship between distances and geometries. And it's not one-to-one, as we will see, but we would like to have a better understanding of what geometric space realizes some distance. Okay. The third goal is to understand what is an entropy, and what is a cross-entropy, what is a relative entropy, and to do that beyond the Shannon and Kullback-Leibler divergent things. So we will have a look at what we call generalized entropies and what are their properties, and also what are their induced geometries, okay? And the fourth goal is very interesting because we would like to be not dependent on the data representation that we have in our input, but we will want to perform intrinsic computing. Geometric computing will perform intrinsic computing because it will be dependent on a coordinate system. We will be coordinate free. Okay? And this is a very nice quality. So just a few words on the four goals before I begin to start. So first goal, try to unify former algorithms into meta-algorithms so that the meta-algorithm will work on classes of distances. It can be metric distance or it can be non-metric divergences. For example, if you want to do parameter estimation, you have a measure of goodness of fit. If you want to do center-based clustering, then you know that there's a Bregman k-means generalization that is nice. Learning, we saw yesterday in the lecture that boosting can also be analyzed into a wider framework by choosing some calibrated loss function. Okay, and forecasting for proper score functions. Also, in the later part of the talk, I will try to highlight some new classes of distances that are principal. So trying to find what will be new qualities that we ask for distances and how to discover those new classes that satisfy the new properties. Okay? And of course, as I said before, we want to have exhaustive characterization. Okay, that if it has a good property, then it belongs to that class so that we know which class to use. When I first started this area, there's a lot of history because geometry is a mother of science. You know, it has 2,000 years of, or at least 2,000 years of science based from Pythagoras. And if you think about Euclidean distance, it is from Pythagoras' theorem. Okay, you take the square root of the hypotenuse and you get the distance here between this point and this point. And we have had many distances that appear in statistical geometry or non-Euclidean geometries and quantum geometry and so forth. And entropies can be additive, non-additive. Maybe you heard about Salis non-extensive entropies recently. And we had this schematic way of how distances evolve with times. And we found actually that there were always some kind of Pythagoras theorem. A generalized Pythagoras theorem, okay? And I will explain where this comes from and why it is important. Just in a word, Pythagoras theorem allows you to do information projection or projection. It's a projection mechanism, okay? So this kind of poster, actually, you could have you have dictionary of distances, but we would like to organize it into two or three main classes and to understand what are the main differences between those distances. Okay. So the second goal is to understand the distances and the geometries. Okay. It's not one to one. Okay. You can have several distances that can be realized or implemented by the same geometry. I will give you some examples later. And you can think of geometry as a meta-model, okay? This is where your data lies. So this is a data space. And in geometry, what we can do is we can embed the geometry into larger geometry, right? Like we can see a Riemannian geometry into a high-dimensional Euclidean geometry, right? So it is, by analogy, how to embed a model into a higher model, okay? And we will have this technical description during the talk. I will show you several ways to build geometry. One will be the Riemannian geometry with metric distances, triangle inequality and symmetry. And one that is called from information geometry is what we call the dually coupled affine differential geometry. And I will take some time to explain you this geometry and how it's different from the Riemannian one, and why is it important for manipulating distribution, statistical distribution. And the goal of this is to define statistical manifolds, okay? When you have a set of parametric distribution, what is the geometry of that set of distributions? So the third goal is about entropies, and you know that from Shannon entropy, you can define cross entropy and relative entropy that is called Kullback-Leibler divergence. And this can be generalized by what we call deformed logarithm. So instead of taking the natural logarithm here for Shannon, you have an extension of the logarithm function that gives rise to generalized entropy. And entropy is nice for also estimating distribution given moment constraints. It's a maximum entropy principle. And we will see how that plays with information geometry. So we'll talk about entropies, information, which you can think of negative entropy. Okay, this is a Boolean. And there's a link also with complexity, from Kolmogorov complexity. And the last goal of this talk is to have geometric computing so that we can implement algorithms and to do intrinsic computing. So this is the kind of paradigm for data science where we shift from having data to having point sets, okay? And once we have point sets, we forget about the coordinates and we want to do some kind of processing on point sets. And the goal is to be unbiased by the underlying representation. Whether you use Euclidean coordinate system or log polar things, it shouldn't play a role. And because we are doing geometric computing, we can use the language of geometry. It provides us affordances. We can talk about point balls. We can talk about the notion of what is orthogonality, what is a projection, what is a Pythagoras theorem, what is a submanifold. So we have those language words that we can use to build algorithms. And geometry is also very attractive because we can do it in the Descartes way by writing down equations and solving equations. This is the analytic geometry approach. Or we can do synthetic geometry, you know, like rules and compass things. And sometimes when you don't have a closed form solution for your problem, you can exactly characterize that the solution, for example, is at the intersection of two curves, okay? So you can characterize geometrically the uniqueness and where is your solution, but you don't have closed form equation for that. So it's nice. And geometry is all about invariance, okay? And since we will manipulate probability distribution, we will mention what is statistical invariance, okay? So this is this geometrizing of the probability spaces that leads to the notion of statistical manifolds. Okay, so let's go for the first part of it. The first part is more a descriptive, basic introduction to information geometry. So we will look at the geometry of statistical manifolds. And the outline of this first part is as follows. First, I will recall very basic things about Fisher information, Kramer-Rao-Lauer bound, and the notion of sufficiency. Then I will present the two main structures from differential geometry to model population spaces, you know, like a set of Gaussian distributions, the population space. Then I will present the maximum entropy and how it loops back to this geometric modeling. And we will see the concept of information projection, and I will make several examples on how to do information projection for solving problems. Okay, so this will be for the next 60-70 minutes. Okay. So the very starting point of information geometry is the Fisher information. This is the notion of what is the information into a sample set. And so it's a statistical information, and for a parametric distribution with a parameter theta, we just note it I of theta. Okay. But before doing the precise definition, I just want to do a very quick recall of probability theory. So usually what we do is we distinguish between a discrete distribution like Bernoulli, binomial, and so forth. Here we have a full catalog of discrete random variables and continuous random variables like exponential distribution, normal, and so forth. Okay, and we have this kind of messy distinction between putting an integral here and summation here. Okay, so this is not a problem, but this is the old way of doing it. And when we have a data, we can transform the data sets of observation into the empirical distribution as follows. Okay, we just count the frequency. And we write the empirical distribution in this way, okay? And when we want to estimate, usually we can use the method of the moments, where we match the sample moments with the moment of the distribution to estimate the parameters, okay? And for describing entropy, again, you usually have a distinction between discrete random variable, where you have Shannon entropy that is written in that way, okay? Or if you have a continuous random variable, we talk about differential entropy. And here we put the integral, okay? So we have a distinction. Here, it's always positive. Here, differential entropy can be negative. For example, if you take a multivariate normals, then you can have you have the differential entropy that is this guy, where here you have the determinant of the covariance matrix. If it is small enough, then it's in the log, then it can be negative. Okay, so it's a bit disturbing because you think of entropy as uncertainty, and discrete case positive, continuous differential entropy can be negative. So we will see things like that. In statistics, we often use mixture models. So for example, the Gaussian mixture model is probably one of your favorite tools to be flexible into absorbing the data as a sponge, you know. And when you have a Gaussian mixture model, if you want to sample from a Gaussian mixture model, basically it's a doubly stochastic process where you have to choose a component of the Gaussian that you will select according to some weight components here. This is a unit vector. And then once you have chosen the component, you just sample from the normal distribution, okay? So basically, we throw dice if we have a K component GMM. Then we look at which at the face of the dice that tell us the component. And then we estimate a random variate from a normal distribution. Here, we just do it using this trick by using Cholesky things. This is fairly standard. So it's a doubly stochastic process, okay? And, okay, so when we have mixture models, we can have mixture models of Bernoulli distribution, so it's a random discrete variables, or mixture models of Gaussian distributions, it's continuous things, but we cannot usually blend both, okay? So what if we have a mixture that has some Gaussian and binomial distribution? It's neither continuous or nor discrete. Okay, so then we are stuck, and it was the old formalism of probability. So in 1933, Kolmogorov made a very nice axiomatic approach of probability theory, and one of the goals is to make it a clean framework, but also to unify discrete and continuous random variables as probability measures. Okay, so we talk now about probability measures. And for probability measures, usually, for before you have mass function and density functions, you replace Wu's notion by what we call Radon-Nikodym derivatives. So that you have only one formulae for the expectation here, you don't have the sum, because if you take as a counting measure, the integral here is replaced by the sum, usual sum. Okay, so it makes unify all the writings of equation in the the remainder. So what is a probability space? It's very fast recalling. So basically, we have X that is a sample space. Then we have a subset of X that have good properties that are closed by countability and intersection, union, and complements. It's called a sigma algebra. Then we have a measurable space. And we define a measure here, okay? And the probability of the measure for a pairwise disjoint sequence here is just a sum, okay? So this is what you already are familiar with. And we have either a positive measure space or a probability space if the measure sums up to 1 for the full sample space, okay? So what is a random variable? So to explain the random variables, we need to define what is a measurable function. So between two sample space X and Y, it is just having this property, so function, so that for each subset J of cal J here, you have it into the corresponding subset of the sigma algebra of X, okay? And the random variable is just a measurable function. So this is a very quick introduction because we will use that not to distinguish between continuous and discrete random variables. Okay, we have one last concept, very basic concept, is the notion of a measure that is dominated by another measure, and we will put this symbol here. And what it means is that if mu is dominated by nu, then if you have nu of e equals zero, then you have mu of e equals zero. Okay. And once you have a measure dominated by another, you can write this kind of density, okay, which is what we will use. And you can then compute the mass for an event E as the integral here, okay? And then you write down the Shannon entropy now in unified way in that way, okay? Okay, paralytic estimation. So we are given a set of IID, independently identical and distributed samples, and we assume that it is from a parametric model, and what we want to do is to estimate this value of theta zero, okay? So the observation set, we can also consider it as a random vectors, okay? And one typical approach that was proposed by Fisher is the maximum likelihood principle, where we just take the argmax of the product of the probabilities. And this is equivalent to taking the logarithm of that, and the logarithm of the product is the sum of the logarithm, okay? So here you have the log likelihood functions. And we will say that an estimator is consistent if your estimator tends to the true value when you have enough samples, when it tends asymptotically to infinity. And to compute this estimator, we will introduce a score function, which is the gradient of the log likelihood. Okay, and so the gradient is here, and sometimes we will write partial I for this notation. Okay, so the score indicates the sensitivity of the log likelihood curve. Okay, and we have a unique maximum for strictly concave log likelihood. Okay, like multivariate normals, beta, Poisson, or Dirichlet. So now we are ready to define Fisher information that will be our very basic tool to define geometry of probability distributions. So informally, it's the amount of information that an observable random variable X carries about an unknown parameter. Okay? If we took the first moment of the score, then we find out this. Okay, this is the first moment of the score. We find out it is zero, so it's not discriminating. But if we take the second moment of the score here, we define Fisher information matrix in this way, okay? And for multi-parameter, it's a matrix. It's a positive symmetric semi-definite matrix where each entry is the expectation of those things here, which is a partial derivative of the log likelihood function, okay, from the parameter theta I and theta j. So this symbol here means that it is a positive semi-definite. Okay. And what we have a family of estimators. We can have many, many different estimators. And we ask ourselves, what is a good estimator? And is there a lower bound for the variance of such an estimator? And such a result is known as the Kramer-Rao lower bound. So for an unbiased estimator, theta here, we have that the variance is greater with respect to the lower linear ordering of the inverse of the Fisher information matrix. Okay? And if we have this bound, then we say that our estimator is efficient. And the MLE, maximum likelihood estimator, has also some good property. It is asymptotically normal on theta. Okay? So we have the MLE estimator here with the hat theta, which is distributed with center as a real parameter, and here this is the covariance matrix, okay? So how does it look like? We will have basically two test cases. One is for the multinomial discrete distribution, where we have a set of weights that sum up to one, so it's a point in the probability simplex, and the information Fisher information matrix looks like that, okay? And one often family of probability distribution is the multivariate normals. And here we will have the coefficient of the Fisher information matrix that writes down like that. Okay? So you have explicit writing of the coefficients of the Fisher information matrix. Okay. So Fisher information matrix has some good properties. If I change the way that, for example, if I take a Gaussian distribution, theta is mu sigma, okay? And now I want to reparameterize. Maybe I want to have a mu square sigma to the fourth, for example, a new parametrization of my family that I call eta, okay? And there's a one-to-one matching between those two parameters. Then the Fisher information matrix transforms like that by covariance parametrization, where Gij here is a Jacobian matrix. Okay, so Fisher information matrix depends on the chosen parametrization. But you know that if you change the coordinate system of your family, then you have this expression to change the Fisher information matrix. This is what we call covariance. Okay. One other important concept in statistics is the notion of sufficiency. So that we will say that T, a statistic T, is sufficient if the probability of X knowing T and theta is the same as the probability of knowing X given T. So this means that all the information about the parameter theta is contained into your statistics. Okay? And what we have is that the Fisher information matrix is always less or equal to the random variable here, except that if you choose for S, a sufficient statistics. And how do we know that we have a sufficient statistics in practice? If you can make this factorization, which is called the Fisher-Neyman factorization criterion, so you have your probability distribution that can be written into this this form, then you know that T of X is a sufficient statistics. Okay, so if you write the Gaussian distribution and you make this canonical factorization, you will find that it has two sufficient statistics, which is x and x squared. Okay? So this means that once you have the sufficient statistics, you can do data reduction because your n observation, you can be summarized into two numbers. And whatever the estimation method that you will choose later, based on those two numbers, you don't have a loss of statistical information, you will be able to estimate the parameter theta. For example, if you take the MLE, then you know that for mu, it is a sample mean. Okay, so this is from the first statistics here. And here's the variance. You can write it like that, and you can write it as this equation depending on the two sufficient statistics. Okay, so sufficiency is a key concept in probability. Sometimes you can have statistics that do not carry any information about the parameter theta, and this is called ancillary statistics. Okay, so this is a picture to say, okay, I have random variables here. I make some sampling, okay, And if now I aggregate into statistics t of x some function of my random vector here, if it is sufficient, I can do exact inverse probability by making inference, okay, like MLE. Otherwise, I have lost some statistical information, okay? And of course, we are interested into finite dimensional sufficient statistics because we have a set of n data that we would like to compress without loss of information, statistical information, into a finite number of sufficient statistics, okay? And actually, those kind of probability distributions that have finite sufficient statistics are called the exponential families. And one of the members of exponential families is the exponential distribution, so you shouldn't be confused. Exponential distribution is one member of the exponential families, okay? And here, if we have a schematic way of categorizing probability measures, we have parametric, non-parametric, then we have exponential families. And here you can see many things that you have already seen in your life, maybe Gaussian, Rayleigh, exponential, Bernoulli, Poisson. So you have discrete continuous and Dirichlet, Weibull. And what are non-exponential families is like, for example, the uniform distribution, the Cauchy distribution, because Cauchy distribution have non-finite moment, we will see later. And also alpha stable distribution. Okay, so it's time to give a definition of what is an exponential family. So an exponential family is a set of parametric distribution that have the following canonical distribution. So your density, depending on your parameter theta, can be written into that form. Okay, so it's exponential of some inner product. So here, if you have vector, it's just a scalar product. Of sufficient statistics minus something that depends on the parameter plus an additive term here, k of x. And if you take the log Laplace transform, this is called the log normalizer because you know that integral of that should be equal to 1. So because it doesn't depend on x, you put it on this way and you find this expression, okay? And actually, this canonical decomposition, you can unravel it in many well-known distributions. So you have an unifier way to handle distributions that you already know, like normal, gamma, and so forth. But usually, they are not given in the theta parametrization. They are given in the other parametrization that we call lambda. For example, the Gaussian distribution, as we will see with mu sigma, will be our lambda parameters, but they have natural parametrization that can be written into an exponential family. So this function f here is has a property that it is strictly convex on a convex natural parameter space. And the natural parameter space here is a set of theta for which f of theta is finite. And if we want to compute the Fisher information matrix of an exponential family, it's just the Hessian. And since f is convex, then this means that you can see that the Fisher information matrix is positive definite in that case. Not semi-definite, but definite. Okay? And we have a nice expression for finding the maximum likelihood estimator, a unified expression for the maximum likelihood estimator. We know that if we take the average sufficient statistics here, okay, then we have the parameter that is given into a dual representation that we call the moment parametrization, because exponential families can be parametrized either into natural parameters or into moment parameters, which is just taking the gradient here, and it is equivalent to taking the expectation of the sufficient statistics. So because f is convex, we are going to have a lot of play with convex conjugates, okay? So it's I'm going to introduce the convex duality by the Legendre Fenchel transformation. So once, if you have a convex function with a domain, you always have a convex conjugate with with a dual domain. And this is related by the Legendre Fenchel transformation. So take f as a convex function here. And we will define the convex conjugate by f star here as a sub of this thing, okay? So for vectors, you just take the scalar product, okay? And now, because f is convex, if you set the derivative to zero, then you find that y should be the gradient, okay? And that means also if you take twice the derivative, the Hessian, you find that it is negative definite, so it's unique. And basically, once you have a convex function, you have always another associated convex conjugate with an associated domain, okay? Which is a kind of gradient domain here. So it's a very well-known tool. I think we have seen it already in the past lectures. I just want to give you an interpretation. Here, I take a convex function, okay, kind of paraboloid. Now I forget about the coordinate system. So I can see this, and I draw this epigraph, okay? So this is a convex body here, okay? And now, for this convex body, I can see it as a convex hull of all the points on the border, or I can see this convex object as the intersection of all the half spaces that contains on the half space the object. Okay, so in one case, we will talk about the V representation for the vertex representation, and in the second case, we will call it the half space representation or H representation. And if you make for a point here the tangent hyperplane, and you cut it here, you have the convex conjugate here. So this is why it is sometimes called the slope transform. The Legendre transformation is called the slope transform. Okay, so we have good properties of the Legendre duality. First, the gradients of f and f star are reciprocal to each other. They are inverse, okay? But to compute Nabla f star, we may need to have a numerical approximation because this we have. We have f, so we can derivate. We can compute the gradient. But to take the inverse, sometimes it's not in closed form, okay? So this is a very delicate point, actually. If we have f to be a convex function, then it is involutive transformation. So if you take it twice, you get it back, okay? If your original f is not convex, then it's a bit different. You get the convex hull of the of f. And you can express it f star, okay? I told you that it is this thing. The sup of that for, and I show you that the sup of that is obtained for this. So if you plug into that, you have this expression. Okay, so it is a closed form solution if you can take the inverse of the gradient. Otherwise, you cannot manipulate it explicitly. And what is very nice is that we have a so-called inequality, the Fenchel-Young inequality, that says that the primal convex and plus the dual Legendre convex conjugate is always greater than that, okay, the inner product. And this is a very basic tool in information geometry to define what we call the canonical divergence. I put this guy on this side, and I know that it is always greater or equal to zero. So this is a notion of dissimilarity, okay, between x and y. So we will call it the canonical divergence here between x and y. Okay, so for exponential families, D is the number of parameters in my exponential family. For example, for Gaussian distribution mu sigma, I have order 2. But it is for univariate Gaussian, small d is 1. And we have seen that we have many parameterizations possible, but two are canonical. One are called the natural parameters, and the other one is called the expectation parameters. Okay? And they are related by the Legendre transformation. So the canonical decomposition of exponential families that I wrote before is not unique. It's not unique because you can write it like that. So if you have a constant, I can put the constant into my convex function, or I can put it into this auxiliary term here. Or if I have a natural parameter, I can play with some affine transformation here and play back with sufficient statistics, okay? So you may see sometimes different canonical parameterization. It's not unique. So to give you some examples, for example, the Rayleigh distribution, this is a usual density. It's used in ultrasound for making a mixture of a Rayleigh distribution. Then it's univariate distribution. There's only one parameter, so it's order one. If we write it into the canonical decomposition, we will find the natural parameter space. We will find the log normalizer, okay? And we will find that the sufficient statistics is x squared, and that the auxiliary term is log x. And actually, the Rayleigh distribution is one example of a bigger family that is called the Weibull family, okay? And if we have Gaussian mixture models for the Gaussian distribution with mean mu and sigma, so you have this density expression here. Actually, I wrote it with a Malanowitz distance in these things, but it will become precise very soon. And so it's a multivariate. D is multivariate. The number of parameter is mu d plus a symmetric matrix d plus 1 over 2. So it's d plus 3 over 2. The natural parameters here, you have a vector part and a matrix part, okay? And the log normalizer writes like that. And the sufficient statistics here can be written like that, okay? And the auxiliary term is zero in that case. So when we estimate the maximum likelihood estimator for exponential families, we can do it in either parametrization. Natural parameter, if I do it in the natural parameter theta, then I have to solve this problem here, and this is a convex optimization problem, okay? But if I do it in the expectation parameter, it is a trivial solution, that it is the average of the sufficient statistics, okay? The problem is that when I want to convert back this moment parameter to the natural parameter, if I don't have Nablaeff, the inverse of Nablaeff into a closed form, then I won't be able to have a theta in closed form solution. Okay? So sometimes I will have algorithms that try to stick to the moment power optimization until the last stage, okay, to avoid this, this mapping. New exponential families are also very interesting, guys, because it's universal families. Whatever, if you have a smooth density, then you can always represent it by either a mixture of exponential families, that we know that we can take a mixture of Gaussians to approximate arbitrarily smoothly a density, or we can just take one exponential family, not a mixture, but just one. In that case, it will be multimodal, maybe. But we will have to choose sufficient statistics in some bases, like, for example, the polynomial bases or the polylog bases, okay? But in that case, because the log normalizer here, f of theta, is written like that, we cannot compute this integral in closed form, okay? This is a very well-known problem. And people doing statistical physics and analyzing distribution at equilibrium position, they introduce an energy function here. Okay, and they write the distribution in that canonical way. So in that case, z of theta is a normalization factor once again. It's called the partition function. Okay, and the relationship between f of theta and z of theta is just a logarithm. Okay, so exponential families, you can see it in many different ways. Okay, so let's start with information geometry now that we have the very basic tools. So here I have my space of probability distribution. I have a parametric family of distribution. Let's say that's a parametric set of Gaussian distribution. And here, if I'm given a set of observation, x1, xn, then I know that the moment parametrization, it is just the average, and it corresponds to this point here, hat of p, okay? And in information geometry, this is called the observed point. We call it the observed point, okay? And later, we shall see that this observed point can be obtained by what we call M projection from the empirical distribution to that. I will give you a picture for that. Okay. So this is, again, for the MLE of exponential family, we know that the moment estimator is just the average of the sufficient statistics, or in natural parameter space, this is that. And we know that the value obtained for the maximum likelihood can be written like that, okay? If you just do some rewriting, of the sum of the log likelihood, you will find this thing, okay? And F star is called sometimes a negative entropy or information, okay? And again, the problem is that when you don't have this in closed form, then you have other methods. Maybe you heard about contrastive divergence or score matching and so forth. Okay. So now I will go into the core of the basics of information geometry, and I will present two structures. One is the Riemannian structures for modeling a population space, a family of Gaussian, say. And the other is an information geometric structure that will be more detailed. There are two structures here. Here we will see that there's a J that is common. This is a metric tensor, as we will see. And in information geometry, we will have what we call dually affine connections. So people can write it like that, or they can write it like that, where here it's a cubic tensor. I will explain. Okay, people have been trying to geometrize probability from a long time. Actually, it was thought that it was Rao, the guy who did the Kramer-Rao lower bound on the Fisher information metric that had a paper in 1945. But we found into personal notes of Hotelling in 1930 that he also got interested into the Riemannian modeling of a population space. So a population space is a set of parametric distribution. Okay, here this is my population space, and we talk about to go from a parameter to a distribution. We have technically what we call an immersion. Okay, and so this is 1-to-1, and we have the rank of the immersion that is a dimension of theta. And what we just require technically to have an immersion is to have this independent, but it is always satisfied in practice. Also, if you just consider this space of a zero center multivariate Gaussian distribution, you can also analyze a space of positive definite matrices in the same way, right? By studying the population space of that subfamily. So, we are going to use a log likelihood representation, okay, here. And because there's a lot of partial derivatives, we make the notation partial I to be the partial derivative to parameter theta I. Okay. So we introduce into the population space d times d matrix here. Okay, it's positive definite, and this is Fisher information matrix. Okay, we choose the Fisher information matrix as the Riemannian metric tensor, okay? And Fisher information matrix, I show you this expression before, but it can be rewritten also in this way. So sometimes you find this description of Fisher information matrix. And J defines a proper metric tensor because it is positive definite. You can also write the coefficients of the Fisher information matrix by taking the negative of the expectation of the Hessian of the log likelihood function, okay, here. And if you take natural exponential families, so here I don't have t of x and I don't have theta of lambda, okay, so this is what we call a natural exponential family. You take the Hessian of that, the negative of that, you will get Hessian of f, and this is strictly convex. So it is positive definite, okay? So it gives you a metric tensor for your Riemannian geometry. So this Fisher information matrix for a metric tensor is good because if you reparameterize the sample space X, okay, you make some invertible transformation on your random variable. For example, you say Y equal F of X, then you will find that the metric tensor is invariant, okay? So if you draw the graph density, then if you took some invertible transformation of the sample space, you will have the same metric tensor. So it's a very, very nice statistical invariant that we want. And as before, I told you that if we take a different parameterization of the parameters, then in that case, it is not invariant, it is covariant, okay? So this is two things. And also, if I replace x by s of x, then by the sufficient statistic, it doesn't change, okay? So this is a very good quality of the Fisher information matrix. And actually, for statistical invariance, you can show that up to a scaling factor, there's only the Fisher information matrix that realizes those properties. Okay. So now, how do I define a Riemannian geometry? So I take my manifold M, I put a metric tensor. Then the metric tensor is a definite positive bilinear form on the tangent space, okay, Tx of M, and it will vary very smoothly. And on the tangent space, it induces a norm, okay, this norm. And you define on your manifold, on your Riemannian manifold, you define the distance between two distributions as the shortest path, like the geodesic length, between the two distributions, and you write it, so this is a metric distance, so it satisfies triangular inequality and symmetry, rho of x of y as the shortest path, okay? But actually, we will see that this characterization of the shortest path is something else, and we will reveal some dual structure next. It's just a special case because we use a special tools that we call the Levi-Civita metric connection, okay? So this is Levi-Civita metric connections is implying shortest path and length space, but we will have other choices. So once we have a Riemannian manifold and tangent spaces, we can map to the tangent space and back from vectors and tangent space to the manifold with what we call the exponential map, okay? So it's a local map from the tangent space to the manifold. Okay, it's defined like that. So here. And here you have the geodesic with the initial vector, and you take at time length 1. So you guarantee that your domain D is star shape if you do that. Okay. So this is an illustration between the Riemannian exponential and the Riemannian logarithm things. So I have a point P, I have a tangent space here. I have a vector here, and then I can go back and forth from the manifold to the tangent space using the exp or the log things. Only if there's a diffeomorphism, okay? So, what are geodesics? We will spend a lot of time trying to make a precise definition of geodesics, especially for the information geometry structure. So I said to you that it is a smooth path which locally minimizes the distance between two points, okay? And given a vector v on a tangent space at x, okay, then there's a unique geodesic that starts at x with a speed v at time zero, okay? This is written using the exp, Riemannian exp things. And we say also that a sub-manifold is convex if it is geodesically convex, okay, on smooth T. So one way to write geodesics, if you think of Euclidean geometry, this is where it is you have 2 points. The shortest path is a straight line. So you say, okay, it's a shortest path, so it's my geodesic. But also it has a good property that if you take a vector, And you translate it along the curve, it's making what we call the parallel transport. Okay? It's obvious because I am embedded into the Euclidean space, okay? This parallel transport. And the way to write parallel transport is by this equation here. So here we have the Levi-Civita connection. So parallel transport is defined by a connection. A connection is a different entity. You have a metric tensor for Riemannian geometry, and you have a connection. And metric induces a metric connection called the Levi-Civita connection, okay? And the geodesics are parametrization of curves with constant speed, okay? But you can also see the geodesic as a way to interpolate. You have P, Q, you have your geodesic, and you take the middle points between P and Q, okay? So you will define some kind of middle point like that. Okay? And here. So for Euclidean geometry, you just find the usual linear interpolator, Okay? So the middle point can be interpreted as a mean or a barycenter between the two extreme points. Okay, because we go from the manifold to the tangent planes, we cannot do it on the full manifold because it doesn't develop into one-to-one diffeomorphism. We have to introduce the notion of a domain where we can do that, and it's called the injectivity radius. Okay, so it's we are interested in diffeomorphism between tangent space and the manifold, and we define the injectivity radius as the largest radius, so that the map from X of the manifold to the exp on the tangent space is an unbending. Okay, and we define the global injectivity radius just as the infimum of that. Okay, so this is one of the key notions. If we want to develop two tangent planes, do some kind of vectorial analysis on tangent planes and map back to the manifold. Okay. So, my first modeling of probability families is the Riemannian manifold, M. I put a tensor G, which is the Fisher information matrix. Okay. And if we take multinomials, we can see that this geometry is the geometry of on the sphere, okay, on positive curvature and on the octant. On the other hand, if you take univariate location scale families that can be written like that, it's not necessarily exponential families, then you can show that the information, Fisher information matrix yields some kind of hyperbolic geometry, okay? And if you take the normal distribution with constant sigma, nu, you find the Euclidean geometry. So you have the free constant curvature geometry, flat, spherical, and hyperbolic, depending on the family of distributions that you take. Okay? Okay. So I already mentioned what is the tangent plane at P. Then if you take all the tangent planes for all the points on the manifold, you get the tangent bundle, okay? And the vector field is just a global section of the tangent bundle, okay? And if you look at the distance on the tangent on a tangent plane at position Q, then you find that it is a Malanobis distance, okay? So on a tangent plane, it is very regular Malanobis distance, and the Q is defined by the J. The metric tensor. Okay? And if you look now at very close points, you will find that the Rao metric distance on the Riemannian manifold is also a kind of Malanobis distance, infinitesimally. Okay. So when we take a point X and get the tangent plane here, for writing vectors in the basis, we have several choices for the canonical basis. I can take those vectors, which are the partial derivatives, okay, and then I can write a vector into that basis, or I can take a different system. There are several potential parametrization of the tangent planes, okay. And in information geometry, we have what we call the alpha representation. So, alpha representation is one way to encode the distribution. So we have a distribution P of X of 1, and we are going to make a mapping. For example, if we are going to take this function that is parameterized by alpha, and if we take alpha equals minus 1, we get F minus 1 of that, that is the usual parameterization. If we take alpha equals 0, this is equivalent to take the square root representation. That gives you a different parameterization of the tangent plane. And if we take alpha equal to 1, we have the logarithm or log likelihood parameterization. Okay, but whose basis gives the same tangent planes? It's just a representation. Okay. Well, so given my tensor, I show you that on a tangent plane we have the Malanobis distance, which is the extrinsic distance on the tangent planes. Okay, I can write it like that. And if I do the Cholesky decomposition of my positive definite matrix, symmetric positive definite matrix, into Lauer and transpose of Lauer matrices, then I can show you that the Mahalanobis distance is equivalent to usual Euclidean distance on transform points. Okay? So basically, if I want to do computing on tangent planes, it is regular Euclidean computing. If I transform my vectors with this transformation, I can use any arbitrary tools that you have developed for standard Euclidean geometry, it will work. And then I will map back with the X, Riemannian X log. Okay? So when we do computation on tangent planes and map back, we call it kind of extrinsic computation because we are not really working on the manifold per se. And when we do algorithms that work only finally on the manifold, we call it intrinsic computations. Okay, so let's visualize tensors now. So here I put, this is a Mahalanobis distance, okay? So if you take identity matrix, this is a usual Euclidean distance. Okay, and identity matrix here is 1-1, so you will have circles everywhere. And if I put, if I take these matrices, you can see that it is this is homogeneous. Whatever the position here, you will get the same kind of deformation field. And we say that it is a non-conformal geometry because it is not a factor of the identity matrix. Okay. Non-conformal, it means that you cannot measure angles into that space. Okay? Angles that you will measure here are not the real angles. Okay? And conformal geometry, angles are preserved into these things. Okay? So for normal family here, I have the Fisher information matrix that I told you that can be written like that. If you write it for normal distribution mu and sigma, you find this thing. Okay? And basically, it's almost things times identity matrix. If I take square root of 2 sigma for a sigma prime parametrization, I find that it is equivalent to this metric, which is known as a Poincaré metric. Okay? And so basically, I told you before that the geometry, Fischer-Rao geometry of normal distribution is a hyperbolic geometry. Okay? And this is a metric in the upper half space, but sometimes we want to use different models of hyperbolic geometry to compute. So this is in the upper half space, okay? And you can see that it is conformal because this guy, this metric tensor, I can write it as that function times identity matrix. So here, I will be able to measure angles, okay? It is a conformal. And this is the distance, so it's the arc cos of that, okay? This is the metric distance. And it's also nice to have hyperbolic geometry because if you want to study the space of symmetric positive definite matrices 2 by 2, so there are three, and if you take the special one of determinant 1, then you can show that there's this foliation here. And again, this can be studied as a hyperbolic geometry. So just a footnote. This is a footnote. Okay, so once we study hyperbolic geometry, we can have several models, and one of the models that we like to use is the Poincaré disk, where it is conformal. So here you can see the metric tensor in the Poincaré disk, and this is often used for computer interfaces, or human-computer interfaces, or in network routing. But from the viewpoint of computing, we prefer to use a Klein model of hyperbolic geometry, just because the geodesics are straight Euclidean segments in that case, okay? It is not conformal, but it's easy to compute because you have the usual tools for describing hyperplanes or intersection of line segments and so forth, because geodesics are straight, Euclidean straight here. And actually, the Klein model is conformal at the origin. So if you want to measure angle, you are going to do a transformation like equivalent of an isometry, which is called by a Mobius transformation. You go back, you go to the origin, then you measure angles and you map back. Okay, so it's very efficient. Okay. So for the Fischer-Rao manifold, if you do optimization on that manifold, there's a nice generalization of gradient that we call the natural gradient. If you do optimization, gradient descent method by taking the regular Euclidean gradient here, you don't take into account the shape of the manifold. Okay, so you will be biased by that. And you can do better if you know that your data or your or what you have to optimize is lying on a manifold. You define this gradient that we call the natural gradient, which is just the product of the usual gradient times the inverse of the Fisher information matrix. Okay, and actually, it is what we call the contravariant form of the gradient. Okay. And it gives you a much better way to do algorithms on curved geometry. And people have been doing a lot of work in that area into what is called the information geometric optimization, or EGO. There are a few papers on EGO you can look at, and it's very interesting, doing black box optimization using natural gradients. Also, on the Fisher-Rao manifold, you can have a distribution that you can use for Bayesian statistics that is called Jeffrey's prior. What you do is you define the volume of the manifold by integrating the determinant, the square root of the determinant of the tensor. Okay, and then you define this distribution Q of theta here, so it is normalized to 1. Okay, just because I took this. And it is invariant under parameterization. So this is what is called the Jeffrey's prior. Okay. And we will see that for different geometry, we can make several extensions of that. Okay, so this is a 1945 ways of looking at modeling of probability spaces. And now I'm going to explain more into detail geodesics and information geometry approach. And the key sentence to remember is that we are going to define two dual affine connections that we call NABLA and NABLA star that are coupled with a metric. Okay. In so far, I have a metric that induces a connection that we call Levi-Civita things, and it was giving the distance as the length of the shortest path. Here, we don't have distance; we have divergences that are not metric and that are not length. Okay, that will be the key difference. So let me define what is a crucial notion: the notion of connection and the notion of covariant derivative. Connection is a 100 years old concept developed by Cartan. And if you think of your manifold, we have tangent spaces, okay? And I want to map vectors of one tangent plane to another tangent plane. If I am embedding into a Euclidean space, I have a natural way to do that, right? I can make this smooth transition. But geometry is interesting. I have no way by default to map vectors in one tangent plane to another vector to another tangent plane. And the way to define this mapping is called a connection, and it is described by a prod here. Okay. So it will define a different structure than the metric tensor. Okay, so in differential geometry, you have two structures, the metric tensor and the connection. And usually, when you take a metric tensor, J, it defines a metric connection. So usually, people don't bother. But now, if you want to choose your own connection, then you can choose whatever you like. There are a catalog of connections. And in information geometry, we will use two dual connections. This is the main idea. And these differential structures is also related to the covariant derivative. So this gives the same differential structure. Those two things are equivalent. It's two faces of the same coin. And what is the covariant derivative? It's a way to differentiate a vector field in the direction of another vector thing, giving another vector field. So this is this kind of thing. I derivate a vector field by the vector field to get a vector field. Okay. So as I told you before, those two guys are the same faces of the same structure. I can talk connection or covariant. I will swap words because it is the same thing. There's a bijection between those two things. And this notion is the notion of geodesic and the notion of flatness or torsion or parallelness. Okay, metric for length, orthogonality, connection for parallel transport, and torsion curvature. And as I told you, is when so far we have seen that, and when I was written that, I somehow implicitly meant that there was a metric connection that we used that was called the Levi-Civita connection. Okay, so a connection maps vectors from a tangent space to another tangent space, and if you do it along a path, along a curve, you can map it piecewise. Okay, and to define a connection, because if you remember the covariant derivative, vector field, vector field, vector field, this means that we need to have, in dimension d, d cube coefficients that we call the Christoffel symbols. Okay, there are several types, but let me write it like that. Okay, and then I can map vector field x along a curve gamma by incrementing by a time dt, just by applying my vector in a tangent plane at gamma t, taking that connection from gamma t to gamma t plus 1. Okay, and this is the notion of parallel. So when we say parallel, we say parallel with respect to a connection. Okay, it's a parallel transport is defined according to a connection. Okay, and if you look at the covariant derivative, as I said, it's a way to differentiate vector field by vector field by vector field, then we have properties of differentiation here, and we have the nice property that linear combination of covariant derivatives is a covariant derivative. We will use it. Okay. So now we can define parallel transport. So along a curve gamma t, I choose a connection nabla. Then I take the vector at my curve, so dot gamma here, and I will have the property that it is parallel with respect to the connection if I have this equation. Okay, very simple. It's a parallel transport. Okay. And what are geodesics? Now you have a precise notion of geodesics. Geodesics are autoparallel curves. Okay. So you write it like that. Okay. With respect to a connection. So in general, to define a connection, I told you I have to define a d cube coefficient, Christoffel symbol coefficients, and they are related by this covariant derivative here. Okay, but we will make use of what we call affine connections. So we have connections, and then we have affine connections. And in affine connection, I have a coordinate system theta, where the vector fields I take for the bases to be parallel in my manifold, and this is equivalent to this writing here. Okay. Or it is equivalent to have a flat connection so that the Christoffel symbols are all equal to zero. Okay? Then we will say that our manifold is flat. It's not Riemannian flat. It's flat with respect to the connection. Okay? And before, what we did again is that when we had J, we defined this metric connection by taking that with the cubic symbols here. Okay? And that was introducing the parallel transport and making the geodesics shortest path. And also, for the metric connection, if you have two vectors from one tangent plane that makes an angle theta, you transport them to another tangent plane with the Levi-Civita connection, you will get the same angle preserved. Okay? Metric connection preserve angles. Okay, so once we have those notation, we can define what is an autoparallel manifold. Basically, what I want to say is that in Euclidean geometry, we would like to have a hyperplane, right? Hyperplane is a very useful notion for discriminating minus 1 points to plus 1 points or things like that. So here we need to define the notion of hyperplane in differential geometry, and we call it a submanifold autoparallel if on the tangent burden here we have the covariant derivative of x of y that is belonging to the tangent bundle. Okay, so this is a bit complex definition, but if I have an affine coordinate system theta, this means that the equation of my submanifold is affine. And for us, it's enough. You will see in the second part that everything becomes very easy from the algorithmic point of view. Here, it's a big picture with the structure of Riemannian geometry. So this is a schematic view of what I've explained. I have a manifold. I put a metric tensor. Then I can measure inner product on tangent plane. It defines angle and orthogonality. Okay. Or I can put a connection here, or a covariant derivative. It gives me parallel transport, and it gives me the notion of flatness on my manifold. Here, I have the Levi-Civita connection that is induced by J, and in information geometry, I think the laser pointer is, I use a battery, I think. Here, we are going to see that we can put two dual connections with respect to the metric, and this is really the essence of information geometry. So what are the dual affine connections? We take prod and prod star here, and basically it's going to make the transport of my vector from one tangent plane to another tangent plane such that the inner product as this guy with the vector transported one with first connection, one with dual connection will be equal. Okay? So it is coupled because you see that I use a J for the inner product. Okay? I have J prod and prod star. So now comes the easy part. Before it was like a lot of terminology and things. In practice, in information geometry, we use the E connection and the M connection. E for exponential connection, M for mixture connection. And they are affine connections in the sense that for the mixture connection, I just write it like that. If I have P and Q, and here I have the mixture connection, then these guys write like that. And the exponential connection is like that. And here, f of t is a normalizing constant, so that I integrate sum to 1, okay? And we have parallel transport. Here I can transport vector parallel. Here I can transport vector parallel. So this is the definition of the two basic connections of information geometry, the exponential connection and the mixture connection, okay? And in fact, according to the exponential and mixture connection, you can define a family of connections that we call the alpha connections, okay? And the alpha connections, you have a free parameter, alpha. And if you take alpha equal to 0, you find the Levi-Civita connection, the metric connection for the Fischer-Hau things, okay? Okay, so if I take the two affine connections, I have two coordinate systems, theta and eta, that are B-orthogonal coordinate systems, and they are coupled with the metric in a sense that it satisfies this equation here. And it is flat connections, okay? My Christopher symbols are both equal to 0, okay? So now what is good is that in Riemannian geometry, usually I don't know how to write geodesics, because geodesics, I need to do reshooting for if I have a complex manifold. I have no cross forms for geodesics. Here, I have cross forms, straight edges, either in the theta coordinate system or in the eta coordinate system. So for making algorithm, it's very convenient because I can always write things in cross form, okay? Just before having a 20 minutes break, I have 10 minutes now, so I will show you one over construction, how to get dually flat manifolds from a convex function f. So if I am given a convex function f, I will call this function the potential function. We saw that there's a Legendre transform that has a convex conjugate that gives rise to two coordinate systems, theta and eta. Okay? I can define the metric tensor as the Hessian of f in the theta coordinates, or equivalently, this is the same metric tensor, it's just a different parametrization in the eta coordinate system as the Hessian of the convex conjugate. Those guys are the same, okay? It's just two different writings, equivalent writings. And now, because they are convex conjugate, and I told you about Young inequality, they define a canonical divergence that is written like that. And this divergence is, in fact, a Bregman divergence in this guy. Bregman divergence uses only one coordinate system. Here you see we mixed both coordinate systems to define this distortion measure. Okay? So if we have the exponential family f, with a logger cumulant function f, we say that f is the cumulant function and the convex conjugate is a negative entropy or information. Okay, and of course, if I don't want to have dually flat connection, I can take alpha connection, and then what you do is you just take the third derivative of the convex functions, okay? And you get what we call affine torsion-free dually coupled alpha connections. And this has constant curvature, okay? So if you take plus or minus one, you find flat, as before. Okay, so I have now this was maybe the more obscure part. Now this is going to be a very pragmatic and very usual case, but we will try to at the end to open our mind again to this kind of general framework. So Bregman divergence, you know, it's an old friend from optimization. It has been used in optimization for a long time. So this is a canonical writing of Bregman divergence, okay? And of course, we have Euclidean geometry or square Euclidean distance, not Euclidean distance, but square Euclidean distance, or square Malanowicz distance, that is Bregman divergence. Kullback-Leibler divergence, okay, that is extended to the positive measures. If you sum, if Q and P belongs to the probability simplex, those guys sum up to 1 and 1, so this is the usual things. But actually, Bregman divergence is extended Kullback-Leibler divergence. And if we take the Berg information, or minus the Berg entropy, we find intercooler Saito divergence, which is used in speech things. So if I plot my convex function f, and you look at what this expression means, you take the tangent plane, okay, here at q, and you remove, and the divergence is a vertical distance here. Okay, so because it's a convex, it's equal to zero if and only if p equal q. It doesn't satisfy the triangular inequality, never, and it is only symmetric for Malanowicz distance, otherwise always asymmetric. Okay. Another way to say is that I take the tangent plane at my epigraph at q, I translate it at p, and this is a vertical thing. Okay. So this is another view of illustrating the gap for the Bregman divergence. Also, if you write this as integral path, you will see that the Bregman divergence somehow is this sum. And because this square has a delta theta, delta eta things, it's equivalent to this thing too. Okay? So you have several geometric interpretations of Bregman divergence. And now, why is it important is that if you compute the Kullback-Leibler divergence for two exponential families, members of the same exponential families, you find that Kullback-Leibler divergence is equivalent to a Bregman divergence, okay, or to swap things. Actually, you have several closed-form solutions very easily in that case. Okay. So I will end in two, three minutes. I just want to talk very quickly about maximum entropy. So what is maximum entropy? We have Shannon entropy here. And we want to find the distribution P that maximizes the Shannon entropy given the constraints, the moment constraints here. Okay. And this is the problem of maximizing a concave function subject to linear constraints here. Okay. So it's a convex optimization problem. And we are making it a little bit more general. Instead, we introduce the distribution Q. Okay, so if we take the uniform distribution for Q, it's a usual maximum entropy. But we take this general problem. Okay. And what is doing maximum entropy is that we go from the prior distribution Q. We are going to make an E projection to get the maximum entropy distribution that is defined as the minimum Kullback-Leibler divergence between P and Q, on which space it is here, the space induced by the constraints. And this is the moment constraints, so it is mixture flat. Okay? If you want to solve it analytically, you will find this expression, which is very well known as the Gibbs-Maxwell-Boltzmann distributions. But when you use the Lagrange multipliers, depending on the moment constraints, you may not have explicit solution for your Lagrangian multipliers. Okay, you just know that it is written in that form. Okay. So, for example, what is a distribution P that has expectation 3 and expectation of x squared 25? Then you find that the two constraints are x and x squared, and you find that it gives rise to Gaussian distribution with mu 3 and 5. But if I ask you the same problem with x cubed, for example, you will not be able to give me a closed form solution. You will characterize it as an expression before, but you cannot give me an explicit solution. So, an interesting thing of max entropy is to say that, okay, if I didn't choose the optimal max entropy distribution P star, then Q-back library between P and Q should be greater than KL P star Q, okay? And if I consider the difference here, and I make some rewriting, I find that it is this guy. Or, since it's Kullback Leibler divergence and P is different than P star is greater than zero. And this means that I have some kind of nice relation that we call the Pythagorean relation. I have this relation here, okay? Where P star is the optimal maxent entropy. So this is that we have a parallel distribution. If I didn't have the right optimum maxent entropy, I will have this kind of triangle here that gives the Pythagorean relations, okay? And P star is just the E projection on the M flat. Okay, and how do you compute, and just two slides before the break, how do we compute the projection, because information projection is important? We can make it in a cyclic way, as in a Bregman optimization framework. We just consider the constraints one by one, and then once we have a 1D projection, it's easy to find by doing a line search, for example. So this means that if I have two constraints, I will go from my prior, I will make projection, and so forth, and then I will converge to P star. Okay, this is typical things like in Bregman projection optimization. Okay, I will make maybe the break now, if it's time.
Okay, thank you, Frank, for your presentation. Let's see if anyone has got a question here today. Please ask your questions. We have got a few minutes before the break. Yeah.
Yeah. Maybe you have the older version because I touched a bit yesterday night, but. I just want to mention that the second part will be very pragmatic. This was like the framework to give you the big picture, and now we are going to go into algorithmic details and visualizing things in coordinate systems, so it will be much more applied and fixed ideas into the mind. Okay.
Oh, we've got one more question over there. Okay, you can ask later. We have 20 minutes for the break. Thank you. We're going to have more sessions, so we'll leave 5 minutes or more at the end for your questions. So, please.
Okay, so everybody's listening to me? Is that okay? Okay. So now we are going to see more pragmatic things. So it was more like the burden of differential geometry and confused for people not aware of that. If I have to summarize in 15 seconds what I said before is that in differential geometry, you have the metric tensor structure for orthogonality, and you have the connection structure for parallelness and curvature. So now let's see at some applications, and we will start with information projections. So I told you for in a dually flat space, we have two mixtures, two affine mixtures. One is the exponential mixtures, and if I take the alpha connection, it is Nabla 1, and Nabla E for the exponential, and Nabla M for the mixture connection, okay? And the E projection of a point P will minimize the Kullback-Leibler divergence to Q, and it will be unique on a M flat, okay? And conversely, it's like in projective geometry, you have always two dual things, seeing points as lines or points. And the M projection Q is unique if it is projected on an E flat and it minimizes this guy, where you have the right hand side here, okay? So basically, we are introducing minimization. Here I can write it again with the left argument by taking the reverse Kullback-Leibler divergence. And this is two examples of a family of divergences that we will see that are called alpha divergences. Okay, so let's go back to the maximum likelihood estimation. So I have my data. For my data, I can take the empirical distribution. And now I want to find, if I do the mean of the Kullback-Leibler of my empirical distribution to my estimated distribution, I write that. I remove every term that is not dependent on theta, and I find this, okay? And this is equal to the MLE. So MLE can be seen as a minimization of Kullback-Leibler divergence from the empirical distribution to theta, and this is an information projection. So what we do is we have the space of probability distribution. I have my data sets here. I go to the empirical distribution. I have my exponential manifold, okay? That is E flat, okay? Exponential manifold, it is E flat. Two points are linked by E geodesic with the Nabla E connection. And what I do an M projection here with orthogonality defined by the Fisher information metric tensor. And this is going to be the observed point, okay? So when we have exponential families, sometimes it's good to fix some parameters and to let have parameters variable free. Then we will call those kind of subfamilies nested exponential families. On the other hand, we may also consider curved exponential families. So curved exponential families is non-flat in a sense that the parameters are linked by some equation. For example, here instead of mu sigma squared, I take sigma equal mu, okay? I have a one curve in a two E flat, okay? How do we do inference into curve exponential families? Let me write the maximum likelihood estimator for that, okay? Then I can show that the maximum likelihood for this curve, for this curve exponential family, I can write it as a minimum of a Kullback-Leibler divergence, okay? It can be written like that. And again, this can be interpreted as the M projection of the observation point. So the observation point has hat of theta coordinates, okay? So a graphic for that. I have no constraints on my parameter. I know that the MLE as observed point as a moment parameter, the average sufficient statistics. Now I take some constraints, let's say sigma sigma square equal mu square. I have this curve exponential family, and I want to find the best parameter on that curve exponential family. This is just going to be the M projection here, okay? And we can have in information geometry more fine analysis by looking at statistical curvature and a higher order estimation. Again, information projection, you can use it in many, many different scenarios. For example, if I have a mixture model, like a Gaussian mixture model, and I want to simplify that Gaussian mixture model into one single component, okay? I have K components Gaussian mixture model, and I want to find the best component that simplifies my mixture model. Simplifies with respect to Kullback-Leibler divergence. So, how does it work? Here, M is a mixture model. I want to find the best Gaussian that minimize the Kullback-Leibler divergence, okay? And the best Gaussian will be P star. Here, I have the manifold of Gaussian distributions. It's an exponential family, and it is E flat, okay? Here, I have my mixture model that is not belonging to the Gaussian manifold, so it's in my priority space. And I'm going to take the, because I do this minimization here, I'm going to take the M geodesics, and I will have orthogonality, okay? So once again, you can simplify a Gaussian mixture model into a single component, and this projection, you can just compute it as a barycenter of the moment parameters of the Gaussians here, okay? So this is, again, one scenario for projection. So now there's a link between Kullback-Leibler divergence and Fisher information. If you look here, there's an abuse of notation. I should write P of x of theta plus theta, but I just write it like that because it's convenient. At infinitesimal position, you can show that the Kullback-Leibler divergence is basically the, this equivalent to that. Okay, and you can also show that the Fisher information matrix can be obtained from the Kullback-Leibler divergence by this derivation. And actually, if you ask yourself what is the kind of divergence, when I use divergence in the sense that it is a distance that is smooth and not symmetric, no triangle inequality. Yeah? It is not a divergence operator in Riemannian geometry. We have also divergence of vector fields. What is the family of divergences? So that by taking that, I got the Fisher information matrix up to some scaling factor, okay? Then you will find that it is the F divergences that can be written canonically like that, okay? And Kullback-Leibler divergence is one example of F divergence. We will see it more later. Okay, just to tell you that there are several kinds of entropy, we have looked at Kullback-Leibler divergence that is derived from Shannon entropy. And we know that for two uncoupled systems, the entropy is a sum of the entropy. We say that Shannon entropy is additive. And there has been a lot of work recently on non-extensive and non-additive entropy, like Salis entropies. Maybe you've heard about that, or Kanadiakis entropies. In that case, we have this equation here. So here you have a kind of additive terms. Okay, and if Q equals 1, then you... actually, Salis for Q equals 1 is Shannon. Okay. So it's a generalization of Shannon entropy. And there's a two-parameter family that generalized Salis, Shannon, and Reni. It's called Sharma-Mittal entropies. And we have also closed-form equation for entropies, cross-entropies, relative entropies for those families. So just the reference will be at the end. Okay, so this was a summary of the first part. I think I already explained that. So now I go into the second part, about algorithms and more geometry by the space of spheres. Okay, my background is computational geometry. So computational geometry and information geometry were very active topics in the beginning of the 80s. It was the golden rush in the 80s. And if you look at periods of research in computational geometry, maybe you have three periods. One period is, okay, everything has to be done, so people do geometric algorithms, and you may have heard about Voronoi and Delaunay triangulation, minimum spanning trees, finding data structures for closest points or nearest neighbor queries. And then people realized that it was not scalable because every time there was numerical precision. And when you have an algorithm, sometimes you say, okay, I have a half plane, is my point to the left or to the right? And if you make a mistake in that predicate, then the algorithm is corrupted and doesn't yield to the nice output. So people shifted from geometric algorithm to geometric computing, and they really look at robust algorithms by designing predicates that use algebraic degrees very low. And that was the second generation. And now people in computational geometry are more into the global geometry, topology. They do computational topology, and they have this paradigm of topological data analysis. It's different from information geometry. Information geometry is differential geometry local, somehow. This is more like computing robustly Betti numbers and having some kind of high-level global features of your data. And it has been a success because they made some public libraries for showcasing those different things. So let me start with some very basic computational algorithms in Euclidean geometry. Actually, Euclidean geometry is self-dual. in a sense that it is a dually flat manifold that is induced by the function 1/2 of x squared. So everything theta and eta are the same, so you never see two structures, and we are going to see two structures later. So one of the key structures in computational geometry is the Voronoi diagram. So you are given a finite set of points, and you want to partition the space into proximity cells. Like, for example, in that cells, all the points will be closer to this one than to any other ones. Okay? So this is a Voronoi cell or a Dirichlet cell. And the Voronoi diagram is just a cell complex, okay, with their faces. To define a Voronoi diagram, what you need to do is to find the equidistant set of points that we call the bisectors. And they are defined for two points, P and Q bisectors. And in Euclidean geometry, it's just hyperplanes. Okay? If you write the equation, you find it's hyperplanes. And once you have that bisector, you write the Voronoi cells as the proximity. I should be closer to Pi than to any other PhG. So it's just intersection of half spaces. Okay? Okay. And the Euclidean distance, you usually the Cartesian coordinate systems. So Voronoi diagrams is also a cornerstone in computational geometry. It's used for codebook, quantization, modeling interfaces in chemistry, motion planning, and so forth. And it's also very nice because it is related to a dual structure that we call the Delaunay triangulation, where now you're given a set of points and you want to triangulate the convex hull of that set of points. And the Delaunay triangulation has a property that if you take a triangle and take the sphere circumscribing the triangle, then it is empty of other points. We call it the empty sphere property. For example, here I have my 3 points here, circle, there's no other points inside, okay? It's unique, and it has nice properties because it maximizes the minimum of angle. So if you want to do meshing, it's a good thing. There's a lot of things that are known. It's uniquely defined if you have points that are not cospherical, plus 2 point cospherical. And as I told you, there's a duality between Voronoi and Delaunay, okay? And in particular, if you look here at an edge of Delaunay triangulation, it will find that it is perpendicular, orthogonal to the bisector, okay? In the case of Euclidean geometry. We can compute it in the optimal time with the combinatorial structure like that. And to have such a bad, very gigantic things, we just take points on what we call the curve of the moments. And we have also output sensitive algorithm, but it's still open problem in computational geometry to have optimal output sensitive algorithm. So it is well studied problem. So now let's do that in population spaces. And as I told you in the first part, I show you many things. We go first to the Riemannian way. So by Fischer, Oetterling, Rao. So we take the metric tensor, the Fischer information matrix. And if you look at the papers in 1930s and 45, they were interesting in classification, like a population is closer to another population or not, or to a test of significance as the first geometric modeling of population spaces. So this is one slide to summarize. In Riemannian Fischer information geometry, the length element is just given by here the Fischer information matrix, so you can write it like that. And the distance is a metric distance, so it's a length distance as the shortest path, okay, between two things. It's called the Rao distance sometimes, okay. So advantage is metric property. Inconvenient is that sometimes the geodesic you don't have closed form, okay. Actually, in most of the cases you don't have closed forms. I told you already that if we develop into the tangent planes here, and we do extrinsic computing, it is equivalent to Euclidean geometry in the tangent planes if we map the point set with that transformation. So if you want to do computational geometry on tangent plate, you can just use the toolbox available on the web. Everything will work. You will have to remap later. And for example, here, if you take a non-identity matrix for the covariance matrix that denotes correlation and scaling. Here you have a regular Delaunay triangle with an empty sphere that will be translated into empty ellipses property, of course. Everything transforms by this anisotropic scaling, okay? From Cholesky decomposition. Okay, I told you that if we want to study the manifold of univariate Gaussians, the Fisher information metric will yield hyperbolic geometry in the upper half space, okay? And hyperbolic geometry is an abstract geometry that can be realized by several models. There are dozens of models of hyperbolic geometry. Some of them are conformal, meaning that the tensor is a scalar of the identity matrix. Some of them are not conformal, but have the good property of having geodesics that are distant, that are straight. Okay, so this is what I show you, conformal. You have a tensor like that. And here, Klein, non-conformal, so you can see ellipses like that. But here we have geodesics that are straight. So, if I want to compute hyperbolic Voronoi diagrams, so I want to compute the statistical Voronoi diagrams for the Fisher Rao geometry, it's equivalent to an hyperbolic Voronoi diagram. And how do I compute that? I can compute it in the Klein disk as an affine Voronoi diagram that I clip to the boundary circle. And then once I have computed the hyperbolic Voronoi diagram into one model, I can convert it into any other model. If I want to measure angle, I can convert it to Poincaré model, okay? Which is good for visualization, okay? So how do we compute this? We can show that, so this is a hyperbolic Voronoi diagram with the boundary circle here. This is a site, so you can see that each site could be a Gaussian, okay? It can be a Gaussian if you think. And here we compute canonically as what we call a power diagram for this power distance. So we know that if a diagram has affine bisector, we know that there's a universal construction as a power diagram by defining the right WP here. It's a canonical way of constructing Voronoi diagrams with affine bisectors, okay? And after that, I can convert into any kind of model. So for example, here we have the Beltrami hemisphere. Here we have the upper half space in green, the hyperboloid model. Here we have the Klein disk, and here we have a Poincaré disk. They are all related by central things. So hyperboloid geometry is abstract geometry. You don't have the fifth postulate of Euclid that says that one line and a point on a line has only unique parallel lines, okay? There are many parallel lines. And depending on the model that you choose, you can compute easily or not. Here, I show you that taking the Klein things make our toolbox very easy because everything is affine. I compute determinant, I compute hyperplane, and then I translate to other visualization things, okay? Maybe I can just show you. So this is in a Klein representation. Here we can move it. You can think of Gaussians here. And then I computed that guy as a power diagram, okay? Okay. So. Let's look now at Voronoi diagrams in dually affine information geometry, because we will use it for classification. Again, this is things that we have seen in the first part of the talk. We have a convex function f that admits the convex conjugates, that admits a canonical divergence by the Young inequality, and we can write this canonical divergence by using one single coordinate system as a Bregman divergence. So on here on a theta parameter or on a eta parameter. And if it's an eta parameter, the arguments are swapped, okay? So now if I look at the bisector between two distributions, say by theta and theta 1 and theta, because depending on where I put my argument theta on the left or on the right, the referential duality, I have two bisectors, okay? And we can show that one bisector is a theta hyperplane, or autoparallel manifold, or autoparallel manifold in differential geometry, and the other one is a eta hyperplane, or if I map back to the theta coordinate system, a hypersurface. Okay. So basically, I have two points, like two distribution with Kullback-Leibler divergence. Okay, it translates to Bregman divergence. And then I look at the set of distributions that are at equidivergence for similarity with equidistance. Depending on whether I put argument on the left or on the right, I have two bisectors. One is always hyperplane in one coordinate system and curve in the other. And here you have the moment parametrization. You can see one is, so here it's straight, here it's curved, here it's straight, here it's curved, okay? But in information geometry, you think of bisectors as a geometric entity. Just for visualization, you want to visualize in coordinate systems. But so now I will introduce the space of spheres, because this is very important notion in dually flat spaces. Let me explain you why. It's because you can see a point and a hyperplane as degenerative spheres. Okay? So the sphere is really the corner element in geometry. And we will see that there's a one-to-one mapping between spheres and hyperplanes by using one extra dimension and using the potential function. So because now I'm not in Euclidean geometry anymore, I define two types of balls, depending on whether I put the center on the left or on the right side, okay? And by using Legendre duality, I can go back from one type to another type, depending on the generator. And here, for example, you have for the Itakura-Saito, so the Berg entropy, you have the two types of balls represented in the same coordinate system. Okay. In dually flat geometry, I told you that there's an identity for 3 points for Kullback-Leibler divergence also. This is this identity. Okay. It's generalized a law of cosines that is well known in Euclidean geometry. But here you have the dual geodesics. Okay, you remember I have two dual connections. So you have the dual geodesics here. And in particular, when theta is the angle between the two geodesics is pi over 2, then you have the Pythagorean relation that I showed you before for information projection for Kullback-Leibler divergence. So if you want to check whether it is orthogonal or not, orthogonality depends only on the metric tensor, okay? You just have to also to check it is equivalent to that. The difference between the theta scalar product, the difference in the eta parametrization is zero. Okay, so the space of spheres is going to map is going to generalize the paraboloid mapping. It's a lifting map. What we are going to do is to consider the potential function f to draw its graph in high dimension, one higher dimension. So you have x f of x. So you will have a hypersurface in one extra dimension of this potential function. And you are going to consider the tangent hyperplanes at that hypersurface. And what you can show is that the Bregman sphere on the plane, when you map all the points on the boundary of the sphere to the potential function, it will be supported by some hyperplane. And vice versa, when you take a hyperplane that cuts the potential function and project back to the plane, it will be a Bregman sphere. Okay? So this is what I mean here. I take, here is Euclidean geometry. I take the paraboloid. I have a Euclidean sphere. If I map every point on the boundary to the potential function, And I take the hyperplane, I will have a hyperplane dimension d plus 1. On the converse, if I take an hyperplane, I cut with the potential function, I go back to this d-space, I will have a sphere. Okay? So it's a transformation from a quadratic object to a linear affine object. Okay? So why is it useful is that, for example, if you want to study the Wapnick-Chervonenkis dimension of Bregman spheres, then you can do it easily with this hyperplane in a one extra dimension, and you know that it is of the VC dimension of Brangmann spheres is d plus 1. Okay? You can compute U and an intersection just by computing the polytops on the hyperplanes and cutting back with the potential function. Also, if you want to do proximity location, like nearest neighbor search, you like to build trees, like you have vantage point trees or ball trees. Then this generalizes to Brangmann ball trees and things like that, because if you take two spheres and you make the difference between the equation, you find a hyperplane. Okay, so this is going to make the partition very easy to program. For example, here we have a vantage point trees. If I want to do nearest neighbor, for example, I have a hierarchy tree with from a root and a partition here with a Brangmann cubic labeler ball. Okay, and then I do a recursion. So for example, if I have a set of histograms and I want to find the closest histogram with respect to cubic labeler divergence, I process my set of histograms into Brangmann ball trees for the generator x log x. I have this kind of structures, and then I have a query, what is the closest multinomial or histogram? I will make this very easy into that structure. Okay? And this is possible because the radical axis is an hyperplane. Okay, let's say that, for example, you want to do enclosing ball. You want to find the minimum enclosing ball for a Brangmann ball. Okay? You map with the potential function. You write this this problem, okay? And the smallest enclosing ball becomes the problem of finding this hyperplane, okay? So that you minimize the radius, which is equal to that, subject to those constraints. And it is a convex program. So we know that, for example, if it is Euclidean geometry, it's quadratic programming, okay? And you know that, for example, if you want to do support vector machines and you want to do core vector machines, for example, you have to solve a minimum enclosing ball problems inside it. Okay? So this is one of the components. But we also have approximation algorithm for finding the smallest Brangmann enclosing ball. What we do is we start from a set of points, and we are going to choose a first point, let's say P1, and then we find the farthest with respect to Brangmann divergence points, okay? This will be SI, and then I will work on the eta. This is the eta geodesic written into the theta coordinate system, okay? And I repeat this, and I'm guaranteed to have a smallest enclosing ball with the center that is going to be very close to the optimal center as the number of iterations increase. So this also leads to the notion of core sets. A core set is a subset, okay, C is a core set of S. If you have an optimization problem, then if you find a solution on C, then you know that it is not too far, 1 plus epsilon, the solution on S, okay? And for example, here we have extended cubic labeler ball in 3D. Here we have Itakura-Saito ball in 3D. I find the minimum enclosing ball for packing, and the points in blue here are part of my core set. When I am in a current position and I find the farthest away points, it will be one of, I will touch those points, okay? So core set is very good for big data area because it goes from big data to small data or tiny data very easily. Usually the core set is just dependent on the precision epsilon of your approximation and not of the dimension, nor of n, okay, the number of points. So it's very useful. And to do computation, I told you I map spheres to hyperplane with my potential function, and then One of my core elements is to know if a point is inside the Brangmann ball, on the Brangmann ball, or outside the Brangmann ball. Okay, and I can solve this just by computing the sign of this determinant. So it generalizes everything that is known from computational geometry. In the sense that computational geometry was self-dual, and here by taking Brangmann divergence, we show the dual structures. Okay, and this is making algorithm very robust, by the way. So now if I want to do the Fischer-Rau geometry, not the dually flat geometry on the Riemannian manifold, then we can again find the smallest enclosing Riemannian ball by doing this kind of geodesic walk algorithm. What we will do is we will do the same. We will start from some center, find the farthest away point, okay, if I know how to compute a row, and then walk on this geodesic like that. So this is a geodesic walk, okay, and we will repeat. So we have the enclosing ball in Fischer-Riemann geometry or in dually flat geometry. Okay. For example, if you have a set of Gaussian distribution, I told you it's equivalent to hyperbolic geometry. In that case, we need to find the smallest enclosing hyperbolic ball. And we implemented this algorithm like that. Okay. So I told you that the dual of Voronoi is a Delaunay triangulation. And because we have a power equivalent power diagram for Bregman-Voronoi diagrams, we have what we call a regular triangulation as a dual. And here I show you, if you wear Euclidean, you will get the usual Delaunay. If we take exponential generator, we got this geodesic triangulation. And Hellinger kind of distance, we got this kind of triangulation. So we can mesh. We can mesh into information spaces. Okay, that's one tool. And at the beginning, I show you also that the bisector is orthogonal to the segment linking two sides. Okay, in the Voronoi diagram. Here we have the same property for Bregman divergence for Bregman Voronoi diagrams, but we have because we have two types of bisectors. Here we will have two types of geodesic, E geodesic, M geodesics. We have E bisector, M bisector, and we have two orthogonal properties. Because the tensor is not a factor of the identity matrix, it is not conformal. So it is orthogonal, but here you don't look orthogonal angles because it is non-conformal. Okay? This theta or eta coordinate system is not a conformal representation. So far I have talked about theta natural parameter and moment parameter coordinate system. I would like to shift a bit to symphytic geometry where we can characterize exactly where some quantity is, but we know that there's no closed form solution for writing it down as equation. So let's look at the Bayesian hypothesis testing problem, okay? So we are given, say, two components, a mixture of two components. We will take Wy, and we are going to have an observation and want to classify to the maximum a posteriori probability with a map rule, okay? And we want to calculate the probability of error, okay? The Bayes risk where everything is set to unit cost, okay? So the probability of error here can be bounded by the Chernoff information by finding the best exponent alpha star in that thing. Okay. So we are going to use the fact that for exponential families, you remember the quantity here, we have a bijection between exponential families and Bregman divergences. So if you take the log of your probability of an exponential family, you can write it as a Bregman divergence for the dual convex conjugate. Okay, so exponential family of F equals something of Bregman divergence for convex conjugate F star. Okay, so it's a well-known bijection that has been known for many years. And we're going to use this thing later. So if we look at the geometry of the best error exponent in a hypothesis testing, we are going to define the Chernoff alpha coefficient. So for two distributions, let's say exponential family, C alpha of p theta 1, p theta 2 equals these things. And if you take theta 1 and theta 2 for the same exponential family, you can show that it is equivalent to computing the exponential of a Jensen skew divergence. So the Jensen skew divergence is just this thing, okay? And If you want to find the best bound now, you will show that finding the best alpha exponent, alpha star, is giving the Chernoff information, so that the Chernoff information can be written as the Bregman divergence. Okay? So how do we characterize it? We are going to define the Chernoff distribution as the each geodesic linking P1 and P2 with the M bisector. Okay? This is a unique point where you have the each geodesic that is linear in the theta coordinate system, and you have the M bisector that is defined by this equation. Okay? And if you have order one family, then you have a closed form solution. Otherwise, what you can do is to make geodesic work to find this intersection point. But if you look at what's happening, here I have my two distribution. I have equiprobability of having sample from a mixture of these two distribution. I want to find the probability of error, the best exponent that upper bounds the probability of error. You can show that the best exponent is for this distribution theta star 1,2 as a unique intersection point. Okay, I don't have this point as a closed form solution, but I can write it as the intersection by symphytic geometry as the intersection of a geodesic intersection bisector. Okay, so machine learning were also very interesting in clustering and learning statistical mixtures. So for clustering, we often use center-based clustering method, and we define a distance from the center to the data sets. And one of the divergence that we are going to use that generalize the Kullback-Leibler divergence is the alpha divergence. So here you have the definition of alpha divergence. Okay, it's defined for the positive measures, so you have additive terms there, and you will find that for minus 1, it is a Kullback-Leibler divergence. And for 1, alpha equal 1, this is a reverse Kullback-Leibler divergence. Okay. And alpha divergence belongs to the class of divergence that we call the F divergences. And since our F divergences are written like that, okay, QF of P over Q. And if you choose with the generators, you find alpha divergences. So alpha divergences is a subclass of F divergences that contains Kullback-Leibler and reverse Kullback-Leibler divergence. Okay. And for alpha divergences, it's like for Kullback-Leibler divergences, we have a Pythagoras theorem. But in the Pythagoras theorem, in dually flat sphinx, curvature was zero because it was dually flat. I didn't have this term. For alpha divergences or alpha geometry, we have curvature that is alpha squared minus 1 over 4. So we have a different kind of Pythagoras theorem. We are into constant curvature space. Okay. So one of the problems is that we like to have symmetrized divergence when we do clustering. And in that case, it's difficult to have the centroid or the center of mass in closed form solution. So what we are going to introduce is we are going to introduce a way to bypass this problem by using mixed divergence. So I define mixed divergence for a skew mixed divergence for a parameter lambda for 3 points, PQR, just as I take here PQ, here I take QR, the reverse, and I take lambda. Okay. So I can take lambda equal half. I will have the symmetrized, the arithmetic mean of both sides of a divergence, which is asymmetric in general. Okay. So I can have, if I take 0 and 1, I can get the sided divergence if I want them, okay? Or I can get the symmetrized for lambda equal 1 over half. So for symmetrized alpha divergence, I can just write it as a mixed divergence, basically, as I did before. And if we take alpha equal plus or minus 1, we got Jeffrey's divergence, which is Kullback-Leibler plus reverse Kullback-Leibler divergence. Okay, and this is Jeffrey's divergence, and it is defined on positive measures. Okay, so in general, we don't have the centroids in a cross-form solution. Okay? So one of the problems is that how can I do center-based clustering if I don't have my centroids in cross-form, in cross-form equations? For the very specific case of Jeffrey's divergence, what you can show is that if you take positive measures, so not defined on the probability simplex, but having all bins positive, okay, not normalized density, then you can show that the centroid can be written into this analytic form, where W is a Lambert function, okay, and A and J is basically the coordinates for the arithmetic mean and the geometric mean, okay. So this means that we can do center-based k-means clustering for symmetrized Kullback-Leibler divergence. Okay. But for alpha divergence in general, what we do is we are going to use this mixed divergence, and instead of having one centroid per cluster, we will have two centroids per cluster. Okay. I will have one centroid for this part and one centroid for the other part. Okay, so this is the algorithm for mixed divergence based k-means. So here, it is the same as the usual k-means. First, I initialize my seeds. So I take, for each cluster, I have two centroids now, for the left side and the right side. Okay, and what I do is I make a loop, and I repeat the assignment, where each point for the cluster Ci, I take the arg mean of the mixed divergence. Okay. And then instead of updating for each cluster one centroid as a center of mass, for example, for k-means, I do it for both centroids, with the left-sided centroid and right-sided centroid. Okay? And if you do that, you can do alpha divergence k-means clustering. Okay? And now you can write the equation like that. So basically, we will see that this kind of equation are a very particular structure. Okay. And of course, in k-means, you may be familiar with k-means++, which is a probabilistic guarantee initialization of having a good seeding for k-means. We can also extend that to alpha seeding, okay, the way to choose the initial seeds. So I'm not going to go into details, but basically we can do k-means and k-means++ for alpha divergences and symmetrized alpha divergences. Okay. Now, let me go to learning mixture models by doing some clustering problems. Okay. I want to learn a mixture. Okay. This is a mixture. I want to learn the components W and theta I, the parameter. If I want to maximize the complete data likelihood, okay, it's kind of a hard expectation maximization algorithm, then I write it like that, okay? And this, because this is an assignment task, 0 or 1, I can write it like that, okay? And this equation, I can write it as this thing. And basically, this shows you that maximizing the complete data likelihood is equivalent to a clustering problem. Okay. So, if I take what we can do is to use KMLE for the MLE of k-means for learning statistical mixtures. So I'm going to have this kind of potential function here. Okay. And what I'm going to do is to potentially have components. Each of my mixture, each component can be a different family. For example, I can be a Gaussian. First component is Gaussian. Second component is beta distribution. Third component is gamma, or things like that. I can mix the types of families in this algorithm that is called KGMLE, for Generalized Maximum Likelihood Estimator, and K. It's a hard EM kind of algorithms. And if we make use of what I explained before with the value of the maximum likelihood estimator for the parameter estimation here, we find those equations. So basically, it's going to learn a mixture model by solving a sequence of geometric clustering problems. Okay? So this is very, very fast. You have references with benchmarks and quality of the solution. So I just want now to go very fast on F-divergences, because I mentioned that F-divergences are important. They include alpha divergences and they include Kullback-Leibler divergences. It's difficult to compute them. So what is F-divergence between X1 and X2? Not necessarily your exponential family. This is this integral here. And you can recognize, depending on the generator, total variation metric, Squarlinger, Pearson or reverse Pearson, that we call Neyman, Kullback-Leibler or reverse Kullback-Leibler, or alpha divergence, as I told you, and also Jensen-Shannon, which is very nice, because Kullback-Leibler is not necessarily bounded divergence. It can be, its value can be infinity. But Jensen-Shannon is always bounded, so people like Jensen-Shannon much more in practice. So if you want to compute a Cisar divergence, a F divergence, you have to solve that for an integral on a domain which is potentially high-dimensional. And this is difficult because you don't have cross-form solution for this integral. So what people do is they make stochastic integration by sampling from x1 and then transforming this integral by a sum, okay? Usual Monte Carlo integration. So Cisar divergences are very important because they preserve the only divergences that preserve information monotonicity. What it is that if you have your sample number of bins x, and you make a coarse binning, for example, you have 256 bins, and you want to have 60 bins, so you make coarse binning by gathering the bins, and you denote by PA the probability by doing this merging of several bins into one bin, then you can show that information monotonicity is that the divergence between P and Q should be greater than the reduced bins distribution. And the only divergences that guarantee this information monotonicity are Cisar divergences. Okay? So it's a very important class of divergences. Okay. So we need to compute Cisar divergences in practice, and it's difficult because I told you what you can do is stochastic approximation, but it is not very neat. What you can do is to, by making some Taylor expansion and rewriting, you can show that it is an analytic expansion, an analytic series of higher order chi divergence, where here I put it here. So here it can be negative also, depending on k, okay? So this is again F divergences for the very specific generators. So if we have the natural parameter space of exponential families that is an affine space, like multinomials or isotropic Gaussians, then we know that a closed form solution for the higher order chi divergence. Okay, so this is two decompositions for the Poisson and normal distribution. You will see that the natural parameter space is affine. Okay. Okay. And this property allows us to write this guy before as this solution. Okay. I'm skipping all the mathematical writing, but you will find cross-form solution like that. Okay. So for the Poisson, you will get this equation, and for the normal, the other one. So this gives you a way to approximate very by making some truncation. You can approximate the F divergence for any F for affine natural exponential families. Okay. So this is a nice tool. Okay. Well, I'm going to use now maybe 5 or 10 minutes to show you new kinds of divergences we have been working on. So it's more like extension. And if I plot a convex function f, I showed you that before the Bregman divergence is that vertical gap, okay? But if I rotate my coordinate system for plotting the graph, I have a different Bregman divergence. And people doing, for example, medical imaging and doing diffusion tensor imaging They like to be invariant for the rotation of the coordinate system. So we have introduced the notion of total Brengmann divergence by taking not the vertical distance, but the orthogonal distance to the tangent plane here. Okay? And we call that total Brengmann divergence. And everything is linked somehow, because if I define a gap, let me show you. What I can do for defining a divergence also, I can choose alpha here, and I can make the difference between this interpolated between the two points, P, F, P, Q, F, Q, and this point here, okay? And by choosing alpha, I can go from that to that. This is a positive gap by convexity, okay? And this is a Skew-Jensen divergence, okay? I write it like that. Now, what you can show is that if you take extreme Skew-Jensen divergence, it's Brengmann divergence. Okay? So, you do a good job with Brengmann divergence, but you can be more general if you take Skew-Jensen divergence. Okay? Because in the limit cases, you will find Brengmann divergence. Okay? And in statistics, people have been using Bhattacharya divergence, which is written like that. And if it is from the same exponential families, you show that it is again a Skew-Jensen divergence on the natural parameters. Okay. So for us, it's very nice because we need to have centroids for making k-means centroids for those kind of families, and we have algorithm and way to characterize these things. I'm not going to go into details, I think, but you will find on the slides the contents. Okay, so this is a very chematic things. We have distances, we have convexity, we have probabilities, and we have aggregators, like centroids, okay? And we have many dualities. For example, there's a duality between exponential families and Brengmann divergence. There's a duality between Brengmann divergence and quasi-arithmetic mean. So these things for a monotone function, if you take f equal x, you get the arithmetic mean. If you take log x, you get the geometric means and things like that. So we got this triangle of duality between the way to average, the way to choose the distance, and the way to choose the probability distribution. Okay. So total Brengmann divergence is just Brengmann divergence with a conformal factor. It has very good properties. You can show that it makes robust clustering. If you have outliers, you can study the influence function for the outliers, and you can show that whatever the generator you choose, the total Brengmann centroid is robust. Okay. And we have generalized very recently that to total Jensen divergences. So I go back. So now the picture that we have so far is we have this similarity measure. If we want to have some smoothness, we have divergence, okay? We can build dually flat spaces from C3 function by choosing the coefficient of the Christoffel symbols. Then we have, I didn't talk today, but we have what we call a monotone embedding. I told you the alpha representation. Alpha representation can be generalized into a V representation. This gave us something that we call scale conformal divergence, okay? And basically, with that, you find XSR divergence for information monotonicity, Brengmann divergence, canonical divergence in dually flat spaces. You can unify those two into this guy. And here you can have robust divergence, okay? So we got a better picture of the classes of divergences. Okay, I'm going to have a few questions. This is just a summary, but I will leave it to you. I just want to tell you that we have two edited books that are more general than what I did today. If you want to look at information geometry for matrices, for example, or for very recent results, you can have a look at those books. We will organize in October at Ecole Polytechnique the second edition of the Geometric Science of Information. So it's a very broad topic. We had more than 300 participants for the first edition, and people working from radar signal processing to music information geometry to many, many different fields. So please check the homepage if you like. And this I'm going to skip. This is just a very executive summary. Just one slide to say, okay. Basically, when I study a model, there's a structure between the parameter of my model and the model. Okay? And I'm interested in the structure to leverage the structure in algorithms. Okay? And my parameters belong to configuration space. Okay? If I take the geometric point of view, each parameter is a point, so I have parameter spaces, I have information spaces somehow, and the structure is linked with the geometry. Okay? And here, if I have a model embedded into a supermodel, I can see the geometry embedded into a higher geometry. So this is a viewpoint. What you gain with that is you are coordinate free. Okay, and the very last slide now is this. I'm conscious that for the first time it's a lot of notions, and because it's making use of a lot of things from information theory, differential geometry, statistics. So for the very first time, it may be very disturbing, I understand. But for those people who have been into the field, I hope you get a better picture. Everything that I have described somehow is, except the very last technical things, is already 30 years old, if you look from the very first papers. It has taken time to be assimilated by people from computer science community. Okay. What people do actually now, very actively, is that they look at quantum information geometry. Why is that so? Is that because if you take quantum information, it's generalizing the notion of probability. Basically, if you take Hermitian matrices of trace 1, you have quantum states, and if it is diagonal, diagonal matrices are just regular probability. Okay? So it's an extension of probability theory, and it's an extension of and a lot of problems are there to be solved. And for example, we don't have unique quantum Fisher information matrix in that case. So there are people working on what is a good metric for with Hermitian matrices. And I just want to say that some people are building quantum modern works to define distance between graphs. For example, I have two graphs, and I want to have a distance. A differential geometry on a family of graphs. The way to do that is to do random walks, and then to have the probability of being on each node. Okay, this can be a classical random walk or a quantum random walk. And from that, once you have probability, you can define a distance between a graph by the walks. And of course, we can also work on a combinatorial structure like quantum Voronoi diagrams. Okay, so thank you for your time. And I hope you will have a look, maybe, for your machine learning problems next time at this formalism. Thank you.